we will have a clean conscience when the culling starts. All praise to Yahweh Bahashem, Yahweh Shai. Double honor to the apostles and elders of Great Millstone. This lesson will be entitled, We Will Have a Clean Conscience When the Culling Starts, or Once the Culling Starts. What is the culling? In animal terms, the word means to reduce a population. In human terms, it means to reduce the population. But really, it's a word dealing with animals more times. But what are we speaking of? We're speaking of the judgment of Yahweh Bahashem, Yahweh Shai, that's going to come on the Israelites in Babylon the Great mainly. 2/3 are going to be cut off and die. The Lord is going to allow a sort of, if you want to use the word, ethnic cleansing among the Israelites. Let's look at the word culling right here.
Culling.
From Google, it says reduction of a wild animal population by selective slaughter. And you can put that in terms of human beings, of Israelites. Reduction of a wild animal, population by selective slaughter. The action of sending an inferior or surplus farm animal to be slaughtered. And that's what the Lord is going to do with Jacob. He's going to allow 2/3 of Jacob to be killed or destroyed, right? Because of their reluctance, because of their unwillingness to repent in the verb form. And it's pretty much the same. Pretty much the same thing. Let's go down here. What is the culling meaning? To reduce or control the size of something, such as a herd, by removal, as by hunting or slaughter of especially weak or sick individuals. And in our case, those that are sick with the infections of Babylon the Great, which is what? Being spiritually sickened by Babylon the Great. Okay. Being unwilling to repent. It says right here, what does culling of people mean? It says here, to select or choose someone or something from a group. Let's open that up a little bit. It says to select or choose someone or something from a group. And in this case, the group is Israelites. Right? Now, let's see if we can get any more here. And you can see here, you see animals, right? Herds of animals. And oftentimes, there'll be a bunch of animals. And what do they do when they grip? When the population get too much, they'll do what's called cull them, which is to reduce the population. And that's what the Lord's going to do. Because in America, Babylon the Great, he's only going to save the elect, 1/3. All right. And I suppose you get the idea. I wanted some better definitions, but as the title of the video goes, we will have a clean conscience when the culling starts. Why? Why will we have a clean conscience? Because the Lord sent prophets to warn you of the things that were going to come to pass. So our minds are going to be clean. Although many will perish, it's going to be the Lord that's doing that. Now, if you read in the scriptures, this is called, often referred to as Jacob's trouble or the great tribulation. In Matthew 24:21, it says, for then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. So a time of intense suffering and trouble is going to come on the earth. Now, we know that all people will be affected, but it's it's going to affect you worse than any people, Jacob. You know why? Because number one, you outnumber people, all people. And then on top of that, you are the ones that are at a disadvantage, because why? The Lord is going to bring a great judgment on Babylon the Great and its citizens, all of the citizens of Babylon. But the only ones that are going to have protection is the elect. So you are going to suffer if you're not under the protection of the Lord, meaning if you're not of the elect and have not repented, you're going to be suffering. Now, again, it says, for then shall be great tribulation. If you go into this word tribulation, this is it right here in the Greek, thlipsis.
Strong's G, 2347.
Thlipsis. Thlipsis.
The word is thlipsis. And it says, tribulation, affliction, trouble, anguish, persecution. A pressing, pressing together, pressure. Metaphor for oppression, affliction, tribulation, distress, straits. See that? If you look at the word straits, just look it up. It says a narrow passage. No. Used in a reference. Let me read it here. Definition 2. Used in reference to a situation characterized by a specified degree of trouble or difficulty. And that's what's coming. Because your enemy, the so-called white man, Esau, and the nations are going to rise up against you. But why? Because the Lord is going to allow it. It says here, pressure, affliction, anguish, burden, persecution, tribulation, trouble. So that's what's coming during this time. Now, the scripture goes on. And what else does it say? It says, for then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. And except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. So for the sake of the ones the Lord is going to save, he's going to allow this time to be shortened. Let's go to the Good News Translation and read that. This is going to be Matthew 24:21. And it says, for the trouble at that time will be far more terrible than any there has ever been from the beginning of the world to this very day, nor will there ever be anything like it again. But the Most High has already reduced the number of days. Had he not done so, nobody will survive. For the sake of his chosen people, however, the Most High will reduce the days. And that's going to be during the time of what? Great trouble or a culling. Now, we read the definition of culling, and it says to reduce the population, right? This is Zechariah 13, verse 8. And it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die. Two parts, two out of every three Israelites will perish. It's going to be by various different ways. The Lord said he's going to send famines, plagues, tribulation, anguish as scourges, right? And we know, pursuant to all those different scriptures that we read, I'm not going to go into a bunch of scriptures dealing with Jacob's trouble. We've talked about it time and time again. We've done many videos on it, showing all types of things, you know, the martial law and all of this and that, you know. This video is focusing more on, yeah, we're focusing on that two-thirds being destroyed, but on just the aspect of you having already been being warned about it, right? Because as the title says, we will have a clean conscience when the culling starts. And that clean conscience is based upon giving you the warnings that the Lord told us to give you. Zechariah 13 and 8, and it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die, but the third shall be left therein, and that third is the elect that's going to be delivered. Now, if we go to these different various translations, the NIV, in the whole land, declares the Lord, two-thirds will be struck down and perish. That's your culling. The population of Israelites will be thinned out. Yet one-third will be left in it. ESV, in the whole land, declares the Lord, two-thirds shall be cut off and perish, and one-third shall be left alive. NLT, two-thirds of the people in the land will be cut off and die, says the Lord, but one-third will be left in the land. That's coming to Babylon the Great. We can also get it from the Good News Translation. Let's do that. All right. Zechariah. Verse 8. And throughout the land, two-thirds of the people will die. There you go. Two-thirds of the people will die. Very straight to the point. I have more. Now let's deal with the aspect of once it starts, we're going to have a clean conscience. This is Jeremiah 25:4. And the Lord has sent unto you all his servants, the prophets, rising early and sending them. But ye have not hearkened nor inclined your ear to hear. And you see that going on. This is back during the time of Jeremiah the prophet. But you have prophets now again warning you. And what is our people doing? They're pressing play. They're pressing record, excuse me. They're making videos. They're mocking. They're coming against the truth. They're finding reasons not to follow the truth. They're trying to find fault with the prophets. They're mocking, scoffing, right? And some are just living their lives in unbelief. And they're turning up more and more in their wickedness. So you know what? The Lord is going to allow you to get taken. He says, they said, turn ye again now, every one from his evil way and from the evil of your doings, and dwell in the land that the Lord hath given unto you and to your fathers forever and ever. Why does it say that? Because if you repent and turn back to the Lord, when Babylon the Great is destroyed and the Savior comes, you will be taken to dwell in your land after it's cleansed, when the whole world is in ruin. The Savior is going to come back. He's going to bring his elect back. And the Holy Land will be rebuilt. We're going to finally be at peace. We're going to be in our own land. But if you don't turn back, you're going to be dead. You're going to be destroyed. You'll be in the spiritual realm at that time. After your visit to the lake of fire, or even after you destroyed by the Lord. They said, turn ye again now, everyone from his evil way. And from the evil of your doings, and dwell in the land that the Lord hath given unto you and to your fathers forever and ever, to all your people. And go not after other gods to serve them and to worship them, and provoke me not to anger with the works of your hands, and I will do you no hurt. This is the message that the Lord sent. What was your response? Yet ye have not hearkened unto me, saith the Lord, that ye might provoke me to anger with the works of your hands, to your own hurt. See, now this happened during the time of Jeremiah, but it's going to come again upon our people. Now, let's get the Good News Translation. Jeremiah 25:4. Oh. And it reads, you would not listen or pay attention, even though the Lord has continued to send you his servants, the prophets. They told you to turn from your wicked way of life and from the evil things you are doing, so that you could go on living in the land that the Lord gave you and your ancestors as a permanent possession. They told you not to worship and serve other gods, and not to make the Lord Yahweh angry by worshiping the idols you had made. If you had obeyed the Lord, then he would not have punished you. But the Lord himself said that you refused to listen to him. Instead, you made him angry with your idols and have brought his punishment on yourselves. And that's exactly what's going on. Then that's a bad translation. You brought his punishment on yourselves. Let's get another one. Zechariah. And it's, if you don't repent, that's what will have happened. Now, this is Zechariah 7:9. Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, execute true judgment. How do you execute true judgment? You have to learn the Lord's ways. How do you learn the Lord's ways? By the prophets. Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, execute true judgment, and show mercy and compassion every man to his brother. Talking about Israelites. And oppress not the widow, nor the fatherless, the stranger, nor the poor. And let none of you imagine evil against his brother in your heart. But they refused to hearken, and pulled away the shoulder, and stopped their ears that they should not hear. You see that? Yeah, they made their hearts as an adamant stone, lest they should hear the law and the words which the Lord of hosts had sent in his spirit by the former prophets. Therefore came a great wrath from the Lord of hosts. Therefore, it has come to pass that as he cried and they would not hear, so they cried and I would not hear, saith the Lord of hosts. You see, and in the next verse, he goes into the scattering that he did unto our people, which showing you in the books of the prophets that this happened before. But the prophets are back again, and the judgment of the Lord is going to play out again, but worse this time around. Let's get it in the Good News Translation now. Zechariah chapter 7, around about verse 9. Long ago I gave these commands to my people. You must see that justice is done and must show kindness and mercy to one another. Do not oppress widows, orphans, foreigners who live among you, or anyone else in need. And do not plan ways of harming one another. And look at how America, Babylon the Great has turned you against your own. Crips, Bloods, right? Rap beef, you know, social media beef, all types of different stuff. You even created a word for conflict called beef. And really, when you read these translations, you have to keep in mind that a lot of times they twist the words. They try to make it, it said, you know, it makes it sound like a broad scale, but it's really talking about Israelites. But in general, you're not to harm anybody. It says, but my people stubbornly refused to listen. They closed their minds and made their hearts as hard as rock because they would not listen to the teaching which I sent through the prophets who lived long ago. I became very angry because they did not listen when I spoke. I did not answer when they prayed. Like a storm, I swept them away to live in foreign countries. This good land was left a desolate place with no one living in it. See, and you didn't even learn from that. We've been scattered and we was put to sleep for a time. And when we came and told you what the Lord had done, you said, nope, that ain't the truth. We prefer our idols. Proverbs 1, verse 20. Wisdom cried without. She uttered her voice in the streets. She cried to the chief place of concourse and the openings of the gates. In the city, she uttered her word, saying, how long, ye simple ones, will ye love simplicity and the scorners delight in their scorning and fools hate knowledge? And what these first verses represent, men out in the open crying out to you, telling you to turn back to the Lord. Verse 23 says, turn you at my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit unto you. I will make known my words unto you. And the Lord has done that. Because I have called now, he starts with the sentence. See, he brought forth, you know, reasoning, but then you didn't want to listen. So he starts with a sentence right here. He's sentencing you to death. And when the Lord sent men to warn you, so when the culling starts, when the reduction of the population begins, those men that the Lord sent, they're going to breathe easy. They're going to have a clear conscience. They're going to know they did all they were supposed to do. Proverbs 1:24. Because I have called and ye refused, I have stretched out my hand and no man regarded. But ye have set at naught all my counsel and with none of my reproof. I also will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your fear cometh. When your fear cometh as desolation and your destruction cometh as a whirlwind, when distress and anguish cometh upon you, then shall they call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me. Why? For that they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord. They will none of my counsel. They despise all my reproof. Therefore shall they eat the fruit of their own way and be filled with their own devices. And we read this, every brother from every camp, even if they ain't GMS, at some point reads this scripture. We talk about the highways and hedges, the Lord sent us out there to do the work. But time is going to run out. The grace period is not forever. You have a certain amount of time. As we've frequently said, this truth is time sensitive, meaning what? It's only for a limited amount of time, right? So when that time runs out, the culling will begin and we're going to have a clean conscience. It goes on. It says, therefore shall they eat the fruit of their own way and be filled with their own devices. For the turning away of the simple shall slay them and the prosperity of fools shall destroy them. So those that didn't listen, you're going to be left on your own. When the economy goes belly up, when it's a cashless society, when there's nowhere to turn for help, when the government is against you, except you do what they want you to do, then you're going to have to turn to your own devices. You're going to have to figure out a way to get yourself out of it, because the mercy from the Lord is not going to be there. It says, for the turning away of the simple shall slay them, and the prosperity of fools shall destroy them. But whoso hearkeneth unto me, if you listen to the Lord, shall dwell safely and shall be quiet from fear of evil. And that's the only way out of this. Doing what the Lord commands you to do. That's it. Let's read it over here. Proverbs 1. Excuse me. Proverbs 1, verse 20. Good News Translation. Listen, wisdom is calling out in the streets and marketplaces. Who's calling out with the wisdom? The brothers, the prophets, calling loudly at the city gates and wherever people come together. Foolish people, how long do you want to be foolish? How long will you enjoy making fun of knowledge? Will you never learn? Listen when I reprimand you. I will give you good advice and share my knowledge with you. I have been calling you, inviting you to come, but you would not listen. You paid no attention to me. You have ignored all my advice and have not been willing to let me correct you. So when you get into trouble, I will laugh at you. I will make fun of you when terror strikes, when it comes on you like a storm bringing fierce winds of trouble, and you are in pain and misery. Then you will call for wisdom, but I will not answer. You may look for me everywhere, but you will not find me. You have never had any use for knowledge and have always refused to obey the Lord. You have never wanted my advice or paid any attention when I corrected you. So then you will get what you deserve, and your own actions will make you sick. Inexperienced people die because they reject wisdom. Stupid people are destroyed by their own lack of concern. But whoever listens to me will have security. He will be safe with no reason to be afraid. Whew. And that's a bad old scripture right there. And that's what's coming. Those that don't want to listen, foolish and inexperienced people, it says it right here again. Inexperienced people die because they reject wisdom. Stupid people are destroyed by their own lack of concern. That's coming. Once the culling begins, we will have a clear conscience, a clean conscience. And finally, to show you the severity of what the Lord is going to bring, which you have, if you haven't seen it already, we're going to show you now. Ezekiel 9, verse 4. We're going to jump in here in this vision that Ezekiel had. The vision of slaughter is called. You can read it in your own time. It says, and the Lord said unto him, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. In the culling, the thinning out of the herd, the reduction of the population of the Israelites, certain ones will be marked by the Lord, right, through knowledge, that are going to be passed over, exempted from the judgment. That's what this mark represents. The others, let's find out. Until the others, he said in mine hearing, go ye after him through the city and smite. Let not your eye spare, neither have ye pity. Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women. This is the culling. Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women. But come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house. And he said unto them, and to them that the Lord is calling as the destroying angels, defile the house and fill the courts with the slain. Pile those dead bodies up. Go ye forth. And they went forth and slew in the city. And it came to pass while they were slaying them, and I was left, that I fell upon my face and cried and said, ah, Lord, power, will thou destroy all the residue of Israel in thy pouring out of thy fury upon Jerusalem? So it's going to be so bad, some brothers or sisters may say, Lord, are you going to kill everybody? Then said he unto me, The iniquity of the house of Israel and Judah is exceeding great, and the land is full of blood and the city full of perverseness. For they say, the Lord hath forsaken the earth, and he seeth not. So the Lord gonna respond, these niggas are wicked and they gotta go. And as for me also, mine eye shall not spare, neither will I have pity, but I will recompense their way upon their head. You see that? So the Lord is going to bring your own judgment, your own actions is going to pay you back for what you have done. Let's get it over here and we'll end the lesson. This is Ezekiel 9 and 4 from the GNT, which is the Good News Translation. Go through the whole city of Jerusalem and put a mark on the forehead of everyone who is distressed and troubled because of all the disgusting things being done in the city. Why is it written that way? Those that are distressed for all the disgusting things they see being done, they have repented. They're going after the ways of the Lord. And when they look out and they see their own people doing all these this iniquity, it troubles you. It distresses you. It makes you heavy in the spirit. It's vexing. So these are the ones that have shown forth repentance and are not like the rest of the world. And I heard the Most High say to the other men, follow him through the city and kill. Spare no one. Have mercy on no one. Kill the old men, young women, mothers, and children. But don't touch anyone who has the mark on his forehead. Start here at my temple. So they began with the leaders who were standing there at the temple. The Most High said to them, defile the temple, fill its courtyards with corpses, get to work. So they began to kill the people in the city. While the killing was going on, I was there alone. I threw myself face downward on the ground and shouted, Sovereign Lord, are you so angry with Jerusalem that you are going to kill everyone left in Israel? The Most High answered, the people of Israel and Judah are guilty of terrible sins. They have committed murder all over the land and have filled Jerusalem with crime. They say that I, the Lord, have abandoned their country and that I don't see them. But I will not pity. I will not have pity on them. I will do to them what they have done to others. And if you can put that in in our times now, all these cities, all these countries, these hoods, these barrios, you got Israelites acting a fool. Doing all sorts of wickedness, killing, adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, partying, drug use, and you won't turn back. So we will have a clean conscience when the culling starts. And that's it. Straight to the point. That's it. The Lord is going to, hey, like I said in another video, the Lord is tired of your shit, Jacob. When we will have a clean conscience when the culling starts. All praise to Yahweh, Baha Shem, Yahweh Shai. Shalom.